I just moved to BC about a year ago. One of the things that I first fell in love with was just how integrated the green spaces and parks are with the cities and how engaged British Columbians are with having an active lifestyle and being outdoors. And I think that's just something that we need to be mindful of so that we never take it for granted. You know, nature's more than just like the trees and the grass and like bushes that are around you. It's about all the interconnected pieces of the ecosystem. And sometimes that can be the humans that enjoy it or the different species of animals that live there. But it's more than just what's on the surface. There's a lot more that's underneath that really ties back to a lot of our culture and our traditions and our ability to enjoy that and to really connect. Forests are really only nature when they're exactly that, when they're natural, when they're untouched, and it's one of those things when it's gone, it's gone. So we really need to focus on that now. What conservation does is it is a long-term and sustainable solution to having those green spaces for future generations to enjoy. That is part of our tradition, part of our culture that we're so fortunate to get to experience now.
So welcome back. I also want to acknowledge a very talented musician, Paul Bazouian, who lives in Nanaimo, creates in Nanaimo this recording studio. Paul for years has donated music that he writes, like the backing tracks for these videos, to the Nature Conservancy of Canada that helped make our beautiful photos sound more beautiful, I guess. So we got a bit of a switch out in our speakers this evening. Unfortunately, Kathy Martel, who is going to talk about bluebirds, has a very sick child this evening and she needs to stay home with him. So apologies to you bluebird fans, but we're switching out bluebirds for badgers. So one of the great perks about having all 20 of my colleagues here in town is that I have a number of biologists I can pick from who usually travel with a host of PowerPoint presentations on their bodies. And so fortunately tonight we were able to snag Richard Klafke, who's a biologist working for us out of our engineer office. And Richard did have three different PowerPoint presentations on badgers. He's so into badgers and spent half of the afternoon condensing three PowerPoints into one. So Richard became interested in pursuing a career in wildlife shortly after high school in Golden, BC. He's lived and worked as a biologist in the region ever since. He wanted to work in a job where he could bring together all of his previous work and educational experience, and that's what brought him to the Nature Conservancy of Canada. So he is going to, he has a lot of experience with small mammals, and he's going to talk to us tonight about his experience with badgers. So Richard Klafke.
Hello, how's it going? So I guess the other talk was bringing back the bluebirds, and I guess I can talk a bit about bringing back the badger. Because badgers in British Columbia are red-listed, they're endangered, and they're federally listed as well. The western population, basically the subspecies in British Columbia, west of the Rockies. So the North American badger, what does it mean to be a badger? Well, they're adapted for a digging lifestyle, like we call it a fossorial lifestyle. In the top left there, you can see a badger down in its burrow. They actually have a membrane that helps cover their eyes when they're digging, and they have stiff guard hairs in their ears and to keep the dirt out. You can see in the top right corner, they've got the long claws for digging, and they can really move soil and flip rocks and get down after their prey. And you know, on the bottom left, is sort of that's typical habitat. You see badgers out in grasslands, but they're readily willing to live with people. And the lower right photo is an adult female under a farmer's shed in the South Cariboo. And a lot of these photos are from the research I did in South Cariboo I did my master's on batteries, working with the Ministry of Transportation, looking at roadkill, and that's their number one factor of their mortality in British Columbia. So I did my research there, and actually, interestingly, there's three research projects that have happened in the province. One of these communities, the Thompson Okanagan, and then the Caribou, and somebody, a biologist that's participated in at least all of those projects. There's two more biologists that participated in the other ones in the room today, so that's kind of interesting. So here's the Badger Range in British Columbia. You see that they go up through the Kamloops right up to Williams Lake. That's sort of one of the core areas, and then the other core areas sort of in the Rocky Mountain Trench. And they're actually, the Columbia Mountains there around Nelson sort of splits a west and an east subpopulation of British Columbia. So, you know, badgers, people think about the prairies, they think about grasslands. Here's a typical badger habitat up in the Lac-La-Hache area. Grasslands, rolling forests, beautiful area, ranch lands. But on the left there, you can see that they occur in quite rocky areas if there's prey for them to go after. And then the right, you can see this sort of the grasslands that surround wetlands. So badgers quite often are in the area in proximity to wetlands. So that's a nice linkage there in the valley bottoms. But you know, they'll be up in the uplands, like up in the rolling hills where there's lodgepole pine and Douglas fir. This is along the logging road up on the plateau. And in the center of the photo there, there's a yellow ribbon. And there's actually a badger burrowed underneath those stumps along an old logging road up in the pine forest near some couple of them. And in the winter, well, you know, badgers, a lot of their prey is dormant, hibernating in the winter. They actually, they're kind of like a grizzly bear. They'll go into torpor. They can go down for 2 weeks or 6 weeks, and then they'll just come up and run around in the snow and dig out some food for, to get tide over for the next week or two. And so it's quite interesting to see them active in BC in the winter, because a lot of the time in the lower 48 states, they stay down for more longer periods. So what do they eat? So badgers, they're mostly eating burrowing rodents. So the top left is yellow-bellied marmots, bottom right is Columbia ground squirrels. It's probably the two main sources of food in the British Columbia for them. But they'll eat a lot of small mammals, the vole in the bottom left. And you know, we picked out some spots where they were actually digging up these hump-winged crickets in the right. And they figure that, the insect biologists figure that they pack quite a pretty punch of protein because they're about as big as your thumb. Those crickets. And the badgers go around and doing these shallow digs. We followed a badger and then went afterwards and we were wondering what he was digging up. He was digging up all these crickets. So here's a few observations that we found. The top left and the bottom right, female badgers bringing back multiple juvenile ground squirrels to their babies. They'll just target a family of ground squirrels in June and just non-stop bringing them back for their very voracious kids that grow very quickly. The top right is a vole nest where they just do shallow digs in areas where there's no ground squirrels or marmots. And then the bottom left there, we wonder what are they digging up and coming out with? They look like these dark brown pucks. And what it was is we found out that through other ground squirrel research in Alberta that they'll go down in the fall and they'll stash Columbia ground squirrels on the floor and in the wall of their burrows, and then they'll dig them up like three months later in the spring and eat their stashed ground squirrels. So that's what they were doing up in the Caribou, which is really interesting. So come spring, as I said, when they get active again, and the females will dig a den, and here's like a typical natal den, and the badger, she'll go out at night usually and go forage for ground squirrels and bring them back to the den. And then come mid-June, they emerge with, on average, about two babies. And you can see the babies up top there, and she's taking a break. And they'll have up to four babies, but two is typically the average. So what's the biggest sort of threats for badgers is there's two main threats, habitat loss, as I mentioned, road mortality. So this is where like work with the Nature Conservancy of Canada can come in handy, because a lot of these ranches will go up for sale, and with either conservation agreements or securing the land, you know, the private valley bottomlands is where badgers, you know, really like to be in these lower elevation grasslands. And, you know, if we can secure more of these areas, we can have females like this one that is quite a distance from a highway, and there's three of her kits on a working ranch in the caribou. And so it's these sorts of places that are really valuable to the long-term persistence of badgers in BC. So unfortunately, we do this a lot, and the males, they'll travel huge distances for a badger. They'll, in 3 days, follow a male badger. It's over 86 kilometers in straight line distance from near 100 Mile House all the way up to William Lake in search of a female, and which was quite surprising. We couldn't find her for like days, and then we happened to get in a plane and we found them that far north. Unfortunately, this ends up happening a lot of the time, which is in all three studies that have been done in BC, that's their number one factor of death, besides the odd cougar or bear or the odd person that might do something bad to a badger. But you know, another thing that the Nature Conservancy can do is work with partners to secure lands adjacent to highways and potentially work with, you know, highways departments to put in, this is south of 100 Mile House, where they installed a culvert specifically for badgers. And the goal is that as it revegetates, the badgers will follow the sort of the vegetation fence line and be drifted right to that culvert, hopefully cross under the highway instead of over the top. You know, and as we monitored a lot of these culverts over time, we found that badgers will readily use the culverts to pass under the highway. We've documented both males and females, and females even with her kits in tow following her underneath the highways using these culverts. So the good thing about installing these culverts and these highway undercrossings is it not only benefits badgers, but it also benefits everything from black bears to coyotes to other small mammals, and there's a long-tailed weasel there in the bottom center. And we documented up in the caribou over 22 species of mammal, well, not as much snakes, some frogs, also 22 species of animals using these existing underpasses. So this is not even installed specifically for wildlife. The larger ones are installed for cattle, and there's mule deer and black bears, documented fox, and all sorts of things using that. So I'm just gonna, you know, make this short and sweet. If you want to find out more information on badgers in BC, there we have a website, the recovery team, and if you ever see a badger when you're not here in Victoria, but in the interior of BC, you know, you're welcome to report it on the website. So that's a quick wrap on the badger ecology in British Columbia.
While we queue up the next PowerPoint, unless I think we'll skip a video, we're running a little bit behind, so we'll get ready for the next PowerPoint, next speaker, the final speaker of the evening. But I thought I would share with you some exciting news, news that we look forward to every year. But Money Sense Magazine began grading Canada's 100 charities 6 years ago, providing valuable information to guide Canadians as they consider where best to invest their philanthropic gifts. And for the sixth consecutive year, Money Sense Magazine has ranked the Nature Conservancy of Canada as the top environmental charity in the country. The magazine's ranking the only one of its kind in Canada, evaluates charities based on their overall charity efficiency, their fundraising efficiency, their governance and transparency, and the size of their reserve or endowment fund. So again, this is, we've been really, really extraordinarily proud of our efficiencies. And just to give you an example of how efficient we are with money that you entrust with us, of the 20 colleagues of mine that are here in Victoria, they're all staying in our Victoria houses. And tomorrow night we're having a potluck at my house. So we don't live high on the hog, we use our gift cards. So our final speaker this evening is Adrian Leslie. Adrian has just joined us in the last year. He is an expert on white bark pine. He has probably crawled around Darkwoods, our conservation property between Nelson and Creston, more than any of us combined. He is going to explore how the Nature Conservancy of Canada is thinking big. Big landscapes, big time frames. The Darkwoods property is three times the size of Salt Spring Island at 136,000 acres. And it's being managed with the 22nd century in mind. So without further ado, our last speaker of the evening, Adrian Leslie.
All right, hi everybody. As Michael said, I'm talking about what we can do when we own and we work with partners that allow us to conserve very large landscapes and use best available science to think about managing over the very long term. So I'm talking about the 22nd century. What's this landscape gonna look like in 80 years, in 100 years? We know there are big changes underway, and we're as we manage, we're thinking about what that will mean for our management decisions. So what we're looking at right now is part of Darkwoods. It's, as Michael mentioned, it's an enormous chunk of land, three times the size of Salt Spring Island, bigger than Waterton Lakes National Park, and it stretches right from the lakefront, this is Kootenay Lake, all the way up to the tops of the mountains. This is almost 2 vertical kilometers up where whitebark pine live. They live in very harsh conditions. And with that 2 vertical kilometers is also a tremendous amount of diversity. Obviously, we've got dry ecosystems down low, and then we've got everything in between. In the wintertime, we get just piles and piles of snow. It's virtually inaccessible for about 8 months of the year. It snowed 3 weeks ago and my field season ended. End of October, it's done, and can't really get back in there until the snow melts in, this year was the earliest year ever, and it was early June. Usually it's not until end of June or the 1st of July you can reliably get in there. And so these are actually whitebark pine underneath the snow, and it means great skiing as well. So the great thing about owning a huge piece of property is that we actually own entire watersheds. Alpine lakes, this is up at around 2,000 meters, all the way down to, this is the mouth of Cultus Creek where it enters Kootenay Lake, and we can maintain very high water quality and fish populations. The headwaters of this creek is, like I say, up in the alpine, and just a couple of weeks ago, before the end of the field season, it was actually just starting to snow. I discovered where the headwaters of that stream is, and it's a spring-fed stream that's bubbling up out of the ground right next to the cabin that used to be owned by the German Duke that we bought the property from back in 2008. The German Duke had bought Darkwoods in the late 60s, I believe, and owned it for about 40 years. And when he was ready to move on, he wanted to make sure the land was conserved forever, and that's when NCC came on board and we managed to put the deal together to purchase this property from him. And so what we're looking at here is a picture of a bull trout. Bull trout lives in Kootenay Lake most of the year and then travels up in, this is Cultus Creek. It'll jump these little mini waterfalls. It can jump a waterfall, it seems to be about that high. Perhaps higher. I'm a tree guy, I'm not a fish guy. I'm learning more about fish, but so species like this we can really make a big difference in, because we do have control over this entire watershed. So grizzly bears. Everybody likes grizzly bears, and again, these are very wide-ranging species that require large landscapes to survive. And so we've been working with bear biologists for a number of years, looking at where these guys go and what they do. And so just to show you a map, this is the Darkwoods property is the pink one in the middle. And then it's also connected to the West Arm Provincial Park, to Wildlife Management Area. The little white area at the top is a community forest. And then down here, closer to Creston, there's the Creston Valley Wildlife Management Area, and there's another provincial park down there, and then there's also some First Nations reserves, and then there's the Frog Bear Conservation Corridor. What we're looking at here is the Selkirk Mountains, where the grizzly bear are, and then through work with our with the grizzly bear biologist, he discovered what he referred to as a 20-inch wildlife corridor, which is a trail that's just on the other side, right by the Frog Bear property, where every animal you can imagine is using this corridor to pass between the Selkirk Mountains and the Purcell Mountains on the other side. So using that science really helped us focus on where we needed to improve the connectivity. Barb talked early in the evening about the importance of managing large landscapes connectivity, and you can see right here that that's really what we try and focus on. And so now grizzly bears and even badgers, actually there's badgers in parts of Darkwoods, can travel back and forth from the lowlands, all this protected area. Caribou, this is a fantastic picture of a caribou on Darkwoods. There is the southernmost population of caribou in Canada, in North America, I should say, and the only population of caribou that still go into the lower 48 states. And so we work with a wide variety of partners to conserve them. What they need are things like this. This is what the dark woods is deep, dark woods where there is lots and lots of hair lichen. This is what they spend most of their year eating, is this the lichen that hangs off of the trees. And so and by purchasing this property, we're ensuring that the caribou have at least the habitat to survive. Okay. Talking about caribou and management, some areas, this is a place called Hamilton Lake, or also known as Porcupine Lake. I've been there twice, and both times I've been there, I've seen both caribou and grizzly bear tracks. And places like this, I don't feel right. I don't like going there because it feels ancient and like we don't really belong. It's a place that, so some places within Darkwoods, we just don't go. We basically lock the gate and let the caribou be because that's really what they need. Other areas, there's a lot more going on in respect to fire. So this is a fire that took place this past August. Same time that all the big fire was going on in Rock Creek, there's a big fires around the States. And this was a lightning strike that happened just south of our property and ended up burning about 500 hectares in total. And if we go to the next slide, we can see that this is what the fire looked like afterwards. It's taken from the south, this is right on the border of our property. There was logging done to the south of our property, and it burned really hot, and there's some parts of it that killed the trees. But actually that whole slope burned. Underneath, if you're on the ground, and I walk the ground, you can see that all the trees survived. The big trees survived, and everything else below it did not. And we know that is a typical type of fire for this ecosystem, because of trees like this. This is a larch that is, I don't know how many hundreds of years old, but it's experienced multiple fires. If you look really closely, you can see there's at least four fires that have partially scorched this tree. And so we know that this forest repeatedly burned. And this is based on work done by a UBC graduate student a few years back that basically discovered that this is a fire-maintained ecosystem, and we've been putting fires out for so long that all these younger trees have grown up and we're in danger of getting outside of that natural range of variability. And so we're looking at returning fires to the landscape, allowing fires to burn in certain situations where it's safe to do so. And so when we're talking about using the best available science, we have a tree species here. This is whitebark pine. I spent about 10 years of my life working on whitebark pine. And I've only been working for NCC since this spring, but I've actually been working on the property since 2011. 2011, I just started showing up and working on the property until they eventually gave me a job, so thank you for that. I kind of lost myself here. When we're talking about fire and climate change, one of the things that is becoming plainly obvious is that we're going to most likely be experiencing more fires that are hotter, and we hear a lot about species that are going to be negatively impacted by climate change. White-barred pine is one of those species that is actually going to possibly, depending on who you talk to, could actually possibly benefit from climate change because, as you can see, it can basically grow out of a rock. We've got some amazing pictures of these trees growing directly out of rock. So they can survive under very droughty conditions, hot conditions. Even though they do live at the tops of the mountains, they might actually survive into the distant future here. So this is a pile of white-barred pine seeds. It's a keystone species, which means that it drives the whole ecosystem. These seeds are, if anybody knows, they're pine nuts, the buttery goodness of pine nuts. These are very closely related to pine, the trees that grow, that produce pine nuts. And so all sorts of birds and mammals will go absolutely bananas trying to get these seeds. They're collected by grizzly bears, birds of all kinds. In Yellowstone National Park down in the States, when there's a really good cone crop, the more grizzly bears will be up high in the mountains going for these seeds and staying away from the lower elevations where there's more people involved. And so they've actually been able to correlate good cone crop years with years where there's fewer interactions with grizzly bears where the people are in lower elevations. And so if we move on to the next slide, we can see that some white-barred pine can grow very large. This is the biggest one that I found on the property, and it was, I couldn't hug it like that. But when trees grow this big, they're also susceptible to mountain pine beetle. So during the mountain pine beetle epidemic, about 95% of the white-barred pine were killed by the mountain pine beetle. And of the remaining 5%, about two-thirds of them have been infected by this blister rust. It's a non-native fungus that will eventually kill the trees. So because of those two reasons, it's also a species at risk. It's a federally endangered species. And so what we have on Darkwoods is a keystone species that is endangered that might also benefit from climate change. So what are we going to do about that? Basically, we'll do anything we can to save the species. And what we do is we find these healthy trees. You can see this is one healthy tree amongst a sea of dead ones. We go and collect the cones from this tree and test to see whether or not they are genetically resistant to this fungus, this blister rust that's killing them all. And about 1% of the trees are genetically resistant. So we collect the cones and grow the seedlings from, here we've got a great picture, or actually a terrible picture, of a Clark's nutcracker, which is a bird that co-evolved with white-barred pine. So that it is the only agent of dispersal for the seeds. The tree and the bird evolved over millennia to depend on each other. And so if we lose the white-barred pine, we also lose the Clark's nutcracker. All around the world, there are similar interactions between what are called stone pines. So there's a Siberian stone pine, there's a Swiss stone pine, there's a Korean stone pine, and each one of those trees has an associated bird that depends on it. And so in North America, we have the Clark's nutcracker, which we depend on to disperse the seeds, but we help them out a little bit. We collect the seeds, we grow the seedlings, and then, so this is in a burn, this was a fire in 2014, surrounded by dead white bark pine, and so we basically can't rely on the white bark pine that is still there to be able to repopulate. And so what we've done is basically supplement the natural regeneration with all these seedlings that are collected from genetically resistant trees, so that it'll be able to persist in the future. And so this little seedling that my daughter is planting, when she's about 80, that tree will start to produce a lot of cones. And so this is, again, really high elevation. It's under snow 8 months a year. Nothing happens fast. It requires a tremendous amount of patience and trust or hope that it will survive into the distant future. And so that's some of the things that we can do when we have big ecosystems that we can actively manage for some species at risk. And so what we're looking at here is a white bark pine that 80 years from now, if everything goes according to plan, there'll be a nice healthy population of white bark pine, that there'll still be some nutcrackers around that will be able to then disperse the seeds to, there's another mountain down there that's also in Darkwoods. The birds fly up to about 30 kilometers planting these seeds all over the place. And so at very least, we will have a few different pockets of healthy white bark pine populations. We've already planted about 2,000 seedlings, and I've got plans for more. So that those trees will be able to persist into the very distant future. And because we know that we have, we've protected this area, we've got all the adjacent lands are protected, and with any luck and a lot of hard work, probably we'll have a functioning ecosystem into the distant future. Thank you very much. If anybody does have questions about white bark pine, I can talk for hours about this. So this is really tough for me to get into 12 minutes, but thanks again.
Thanks, Adrian. So folks, we've come to the end of our evening. I want to get you on the road and on your way home safely, and we of course need to get out of the school in about 15 minutes, so we'll do this in an orderly fashion. But first, we have to thank you for being here, for sharing this evening with us. We'd like to thank Oak Bay Secondary School, our technician in the booth this evening, a couple of teachers from the school, Stephen Price, who is in charge of the theater department, Derek Shrubsole, who is the science teacher, who also is the facilitator for the school's Environment Club. I want to thank the Environment Club members that are with us this evening, and it's just been a wonderful night to share with you in a beautiful brand new facility. As always, I want to thank our corporate reception sponsors, Kicking Horse Coffee, Silk Road Tea, and Seasider Farm and Cider House for providing the refreshments for our Nature Talks. And just a reminder to those of you that have winning bids on our auction items, please see Allison before you leave the building so you can take these things with you. Thank you for your support. I just encourage all of you to work with us to surpass this million acre goal that we have by Earth Day 2020. It's just a few 4.5 years away. So just to wrap up the evening, I'm very pleased to introduce our acting regional vice president and the director of conservation in British Columbia for the Nature Conservancy of Canada, Nancy Newhouse.
Michael's a bit taller than me. Well, thank you all. It is so great to see that all of you came out tonight and that you're enthusiastic about the work that we do, because we love it. I just feel so privileged to work for an organization that has a vision of protecting land forever. I can't think of anything I'd rather do, and I find it really encouraging to see that you're out here supporting us as well. This year, we will close on 36 new conservation properties, and that's going to bring us almost 17,000 additional acres into our portfolio. And we can't do that without the extraordinary support that we get from people like you. So on behalf of all the white-shirted colleagues and all of the caribou and the grizzly bears and salmon, I'd really like to thank you for your support and ask you to help us reach our goal of 1 million acres and $1 million by Earth Day 2020. There's lots of ways you can do this. You can go online and start a personal fundraising campaign from our website. Encourage your friends and family to join. You can tell other British Columbians about the work that we do. Maybe it's at a knitting club or a book club, a hockey game, but do try to spread the word. And maybe think about Christmas this year. Do you really need that other pair of socks? Or you could maybe ask your friends and family to consider a gift of nature and donate to the Nature Conservancy of Canada on your behalf. So once again, thanks. Please drive home carefully, and please take time to get out and enjoy all that British Columbia's nature has to offer. Thanks so much for coming. Good night.